More than 350 delegates were attracted to the first of GRDC's 2015 Grains Research Updates. Held at Adelaide's Convention Centre, frost was one of the key sessions of the two-day program. In 2014, severe frosts hit many southern region crops, and the updates delegates heard from some of the country's leading frost researchers.
Thanks, Matt. So what I'll go through is, I guess, some of the practical implications of what we might see.
Agronomist Andrew Parkinson from South Australia's Lower Mid-North offered some practical advice on what to do after a frost event, including when to check your cereal crop.
First thing I wanted to go through, which is a bit of a common fault, is when to start looking, and from my perspective, it's at sort of minimum 5 days after the frost event.
If we go too early, we won't get a true indication of how severe or how badly affected the crop actually is. So in my opinion, you don't want to be inside five, and preferably about 7 to 10 days to really show the effects, whether they be a stem frosting issue or an effect on the frost, on the flowering parts of the plant, or indeed during grain fill as far as seed formation.
Delegates were also reminded to look beyond a paddock's low-lying areas. If heavy stubble loads exist, frost is more likely to form. Stubble reduces the amount of heat radiating from the soil. Even higher ground can be frost affected.
And what we have observed on quite a few occasions is that the severity of the frost is worse up the rises than it actually is in the lower lying parts of the valley floors and the lower lying parts of paddocks. So yeah, generally a good idea just to check. And you know, last year, for example, in 2014 and 13, we saw frost events right to the top of the hills, which is most unusual.
To work out your options, Andrew Parkinson advises to first determine the severity of the damage. If your wheat is at the first or second node stage, check stems. Make an assessment of available soil moisture and how long the season still has to run. It could be possible for your crop to recover. Late frosts at head emergence, flowering or grain fill will impact yield and grain quality.
And then we'll start to look at, you know, the person's ability to cut hay, whether they've got access to cutters and balers, freight, shedding, all those sort of things are very important when it comes to the decision about cutting hay or not. And then we look at market access and whether there's a home for this and indeed the value of that. We'll also take into consideration contamination issues, because if the paddock hasn't been prepared previously for it, we might be looking at previous crop residues, canola, straw and sticks and those sort of things, which really limit our ability to be able to find a home if we do decide to cut and bale those type crops. And of course, again, that's probably restricted mostly to cereals. There, I have been involved with some cutting down of and baling of canola, which is a difficult decision to make because the markets for canola hay are a lot more restricted and there's less of them than there are certainly with the cereals. And then you get onto your pulses. Vetch we could probably cut down pretty confidently, but peas and lentils and lupins are one that we generally have to take through, unfortunately, to grain.
Knowing how much of a frost-affected crop to cut is also a difficult decision, and there's no exact answer, according to Andrew Parkinson.
Now, I've got a general rule of thumb, which is when you think you've found the line of where the frost is, go a little bit further. And what we refer to quite often, what we find is a water level, I guess, where the frost gets to, and that's where the crop will be particularly badly damaged, because quite often what I find after harvest is people run their headers into those areas and they say, oh, I should have gone another 50 metres or I should have gone another 100 metres. Just being able to accurately assess where the damage is really, really important, and there's a bit of an art to it, and I've been doing it for a few years now and a lot of people have, and we certainly don't get it right every year, that's for sure.
Grazing is the other option, and like the alternatives, it needs to be thought through carefully.
Certainly the quality of the hay we'll get from cereals is often quite good, because once they get frosted, there's a lot of nutrient that's actually trapped in the stem and in the head, and that is a very good source of feed. Very important though to check, obviously, if you need to purchase stock to put on these paddocks, find out what it's going to cost you to purchase that stock and what your potential income is at the other end, because if the margins are too tight, then you may be better off looking at another option.
Andrew Parkinson. The frost panel at Adelaide's Grains Research Update included key members of GRDC's National Frost Initiative research team. To watch their update presentations and view videos about the initiative's genetic, management and environmental approaches to mitigate the effects of frost, go to GRDC's website and YouTube channel.